to make up here.
You're doing good.
Something.
Real good.
I told Brother Gene White, I've got to stop this being late. I just got to stop.
Did you remember to turn the stove off?
Hope.
Where's your phone?
I believe I did. I want to pray for the needs that you have, I have, and we have. The ones most serious among us, what would they be? Who would they be in your mind? I know I think of Don Norman each time I pray. His sight, being blind, like this man is as he goes into his 60s, late 50s. I think Don now is entering 60, 61. But I feel for Brother Don Norman. And we want to remember Don tonight. And we remember Brother Abimelech, who was having a very hard time with his surgery of his leg. And we miss him in the band. Brother Abimelech Morales, he's a new brother among us, but we love him. And this man loves the church. So we want to pray for Brother Abimelech Morales tonight and hold him up in his recovery. Sister Karen Hanley, we want to see her back in church. She loves the church. And she's in Blake for a day, I believe a couple of days.
They move it today to Blake, and tomorrow she got the surgery.
And after the surgery, she should be within 3 to 4 days going back to her home in Langdon Hall over where she lives. So let's remember Sister Karen Hanley and all the aged among us. Of course, most of us can relate to that. Some of us can. Brother and Sister Frost always, Sister Evelyn Janaris always, Sister Barbara Hines, Brother Warren, Sister Langford. And these are folks that Sister Dolores Morris, who is home, of course, and
Sister Maddie,
Sister Knight. These are aged among us, been years beyond. I think most of us, they're beyond most of us. Not some of us, maybe in the age bracket, but
Sheila Cuthbert, who's going for surgery Wednesday. Sheila Cobb
is going for surgery. Didn't know that.
Cataract.
Right. Sheila Cobb. You remember her?
Brother Wyatt.
And Brother Wyatt. Yes. Brother Wyatt. Brother Wyatt, you got a prayer request.
Yes. Brother and Sister Ross from the convention center. She had a light stroke, but she's doing better. They said she would be in service this coming weekend. And he's been battling cancer with chemotherapy. He really looks bad. He was at the campground.
She had a light stroke.
She had a light stroke. Got out of the hospital.
Brother and Sister Ross, they have a tremendous responsibility there in Louisville, at the Louisville Convention Center. Cancer, a light stroke. They're precious people of God. Minister and his wife there of the church. So keep Brother and Sister Ross in prayer tonight. That's certainly needed.
Let's pray for our son-in-law. He's having surgery Thursday morning.
Our son-in-law, Sister Marla and I, Michael Reese, he's had the Holy Ghost in his life in his earlier years. He's a good man. He doesn't live immorally. He lives a good, clean life. Just not in the services like we'd like to see him be, but played in Brother Monal's band many years ago in Wichita. And Michael knows the way of the Lord. So he's having surgery Thursday, back surgery.
Neck
surgery, and we'll need prayer. All right. Anyone else? Sister Renee.
Tomorrow I'll go for a CT scan. They found I'm gonna say it's just cyst on my kidney. So tomorrow I'm going for that. I really haven't said much about it, but I've been praying and I'm just claiming it's nothing, but I don't want to have to go through that again.
Remember Renee, is it tomorrow you're going?
Tomorrow, yes, sir.
Right. She has this need, we pray it's not serious, but it has to be found out just what is going on with her. Brother Tom Culbreth back here, until we see him get through this procedure, process he's going through with his throat, and that God will take that cancer. Did they diagnose it?
Yeah, they're going to take a biopsy.
They're going to take a biopsy. All right. Pray that it will not be cancerous. And if so, that God will immediately let his presence of healing get hold of it.
Let's remember Sister Marlene.
Sister Marlene, we missed her in the services, and I know some believe in praying with people about their pets and some don't, but that's all right, however you see that. I personally believe that God created all creation and that we can pray, because it's the sentiments of a person that loves a pet. That's deep, that's pain. And you remember someone that has that place they're going through, and she has a very dear animal. It's very dear to her. She's been going through a real rough time, hoping that things will be well with it. This may be trivial to some, but it's not trivial. It's dealing with someone's spirit, their heart, the pain they feel inside. All right?
Let's remember Sister Marlene.
Pardon me?
She has a need in her life.
And a need, pray for her physical area of the need. All right, brother?
I'd like to keep Sister Marla Conrad's family lifted up in prayer. Apparently, from my understanding, they've had a lot of vehicle problems. The fender was falling off the back of the motorhome, then the muffler fell off the generator, and they had to get a tire, which leaded into two tires, and she said, they can take my money, but they can't take my joy. But she seemed to be having a lot of trouble.
They have a trouble. Sister Marla Conrad, precious sister, lives the life. She's a very clean, upright person, and sings the gospel across America with that crippled daughter. The daughter is so crippled, but yet I so enjoyed the daughter singing here that night, didn't you?
Oh, yes.
That was such a blessing to see her sing, hear her sing. All right, anyone else? Brother Les?
Brother Don Marley and Brother Lenny have both serious stomach problems.
All right, Manny, Cammy, Don, Lenny, those are people. They're part of our assembly. Right, Brother Butch.
I've got a granddaughter over at the University of Central Florida. She's having a time. She went to the ER the other night, and they're unable to diagnose what it is, but she's having some kind of stomach or intestinal problem. I'd like for everybody, if they would, to keep her in prayer. It's Amber.
Amber. Amber has been here, and Amber loves the Lord. She loves the Lord. She responds to the Spirit. She listens to the Word. A young college student, but God is able to help Amber tonight. University of Central Florida. All right, Brother Steve.
A lady just sent a note that Big Mike is in surgery right now to pray for him.
All right, let's remember Big Mike. That's some of our audience out in this listening, watching tonight from across the country. And let's pray for that request. All right. Any other requests?
My nieces and nephews.
The White's nieces and nephews. All right. Brother Gene will pray. Brother Embry.
Brother David Hill has been in this movement all his life.
Many years.
Yes. Yesterday. He had a heart attack and died.
What happened?
He was moved to church on a four wheeler and it flipped over on him.
David Gill?
Right.
I just saw him.
Yeah.
A few days ago.
David Gill?
I just saw him.
Are you sure David Gill?
David Hill.
Hill.
Oh, Hill. I'm And I'm glad I clarified that, because that struck me. I just saw David. And then where was Brother David?
In Elizabethtown.
Elizabethtown. David Hill. All right, Elizabethtown. Was he in the assembly there?
Yes.
All right, David Hill. All right.
Brother Jerry.
I think Sister Sue and them know.
Brother Jerry Baggett and his brother.
Brother Jerry Baggett, his brother's been declared brain dead in Mississippi. And this is the second brother within 30 days that has been taken from Brother Jerry. The second brother. And we want to remember Brother David, Brother Jerry.
They thought it would, but they're not sure because they can't take him completely off the machine.
Still on the respirator?
Yep.
All right.
And I think he's also got a collapsed lung. Jerry will be home tomorrow.
Well, for him to be on the respirator this long and they can't take him off,
there'd be a vegetable.
There's a problem there. But we can still pray, can't we, for mercy for Jerry Baggett's brother, Billy Baggett.
And Sister Alice Coy.
Yes, Sister Alice Coy, that strikes a chord. Alice Coy played in the church band here when I came to the church in 1945 here. She is out of this assembly, and she loves this assembly. She prays for us. She's a precious person, precious woman.
She just, all she can do is lay there in bed and look at the ceiling. They don't get her up or anything.
She loves God, that woman does, and there is a young woman. My heart goes out for Sister Alice Coy.
Remember Virgie Fawcett?
Virgie Fawcett was her mother, and Virgie lived on the grounds here and was a wonderful person. So let's pray for these names. You can't remember them all. You may remember them all, but God remembers them all. So we'll pray right now. Pray for the ministry of the body of Christ. That's all the assemblies. Don't pray with prejudice in your heart toward anybody that you may have known as a minister, a church. Pray for the unity. Pray for the coming back together of God's people. Pray for the meetings. There's a meeting in Amarillo, Texas this week. Brother Myers, I'll be out there Friday and Thursday night, Friday, and come back home Saturday. I'll be here for the weekend. Let's pray for the brethren out there. Ask God to help them.
Brother Marlo, Brother Gary Bryan in Houston.
Yes.
He's fighting cancer too. They think they've got it all, and he's chemo. So
keep Brother Gary right. He's an outstanding minister, and he's over several churches in Texas, in New Mexico, Arizona, and we want to pray for Brother Gary Wright. I knew his father, and Brother Gary's an outstanding preacher. And he has had cancer. They've treated him. They feel like they got it all. But that, you know, only the Lord knows that about cancer. But I believe, we're going to believe they have.
Yes.
We're going to believe they have. Praise God. All right, these are many needs tonight. Look at the needs among us. And then I have unspoken needs. Do you have unspoken needs tonight?
Yes, yes.
Lord, see my need. Now, see the needs of those
yes,
around me.
Jesus.
See the needs of your people, Lord. Look upon us with our hands uplifted. See the need we have in our spirit, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
All right, saints, let's pray right now. Heavenly Father, we come to you, Lord Jesus, and we thank you for the time to pray. We thank you for the time to study your word. We thank you for the time to gather together in one mind, one accord, one spirit. We pray, Lord, that you'll help this assembly. Help Bradenton, Lord. Help us to raise up standards among us. Oh God, let our sisters, Lord, raise up standards of holiness. Let them walk in the spirit and let them live godly. Let our brethren live godly. Raise up standards of holiness, righteousness, sanctification from the world. Give us all, Lord, desire tonight to see once again the unity of the church, the unity of the body of Christ, to where that the church comes together. We don't split, we don't divide from one another, but we speak well of one another, we pray for one another, we hold each other's hands up, Lord, and every need among us, every need among the saints, every need among all these requests tonight, every request made, you know them all, everyone, they're all in your hands, they're collected in your basket, Lord, before the altar, they're in your breastplate, you're our high priest, you're bringing them to God. We believe Jehovah Jireh, the God that provides, sees every name, every heart, through Christ, through his blood, through his redemption. Oh, forgive us of any sin. If there be any sin among us, cleanse it, let us repent of it, wash it away, talk to our hearts, talk to our spirits, Lord. And tonight, let this be a profitable night of the gathering of your people. Jesus, our Savior, Jesus, our Mediator, Jesus, our Bread, Jesus, our Drink, Lord, Jesus, our Healer, Jesus, our Keeper, Jesus, our Savior, we give you the praise tonight. We give you the praise, Lord, loose the bonds, the shackles around the church. Lord, move in the church, loose the shackles in it. Oh, God, let us love one another as you have loved us. By this shall all men know we're your disciples. In the name of Jesus tonight. In the name of Jesus. Every need, Lord. Every need, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Lord, the ministers tonight, the meeting in Amarillo, Texas, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Brother and Sister Ross, Lord, in Louisville, any of the saints, Lord, every child of God, give you the praise, give you the praise, in Jesus' name. And everybody said, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord and praise the Lord and praise the Lord. We often say, Lord, lead us. I was taught in the beginning by the ministry I came up under to watch the Spirit and be led by the Lord when we would discuss the Word of God or teach the Word of God. And there's nothing dearer to me than examining who I am before God. I love the subject, who am I that a king should bleed and die for? And I like to see the revelation that I received many years ago, and many of you have. In fact, I think most of you have, all of you have here. But I was taught by a man of God, my pastor, and I went to the meetings. I was taught by the prophet William Souders on the true nature of God and the true nature of the flesh. And he said, no man can serve two masters. And he taught the people to get a revelation so they would not be deceived that they were fighting an angel that had fallen in some manner, or that they were fighting something they couldn't know, something they couldn't understand. But that what they needed to understand was the inward man, and I jotted down before I came tonight, the inward man, the old man, the new man. There's those three things. The inward man, the old man, and the new man. And understand that, well, let's take a Luke. Let's go to Luke first. And we'll start with chapter 11, 39 and 40. If we have our verses, remembering our verses right here. But in the book of Luke, in chapter 11, We have this verse in 39 and 40, that, let's see if I have the verses right. I mean, sometimes I write, I try to remember verses. Pardon me?
I got it.
Yes, 39 and 40. And the Lord is more or less reproving the Pharisees here. Now, the Pharisees did not believe in anything pertaining to that which Christ taught on the inner man and the outer man. And there was no teaching in Israel on the inner man and the outer man. And all the 613 commandments of the law, thou shalt not, thou shalt not, thou shalt not, they did not define the new man, the old man, and the inward man. They didn't know. They didn't have that revelation. So when Jesus was teaching them in verse 39, he was dealing with the Pharisees in verse 37, and as he spake, a certain Pharisee brought him to dine with him, and he went in and sat down to meat. And when the Pharisees saw it, he marveled that he had not first washed before dinner. Now, this does not mean at all that Jesus was not given to hygiene, personal hygiene, cleansing himself, his hands. But he taught a lesson to that Pharisee. That was the reason he did not do what they did. Now, they didn't just wash their hands as you do and I do when they went in to cleanse themselves before dinner. They washed their hands seven times in a ritual. It was a ritual to them. They were not concerned about cleansing. They were concerned about that ritual that they taught, that they had to wash their hands seven times before eating. And Jesus showed them he didn't wash his hands. And he was breaking their tradition down. Jesus spent 3.5 years breaking down the teachings that were erroneous. The Pharisees, Sadducees, Herodians, Essenes, Stoics, Epicureans, their teaching, he rebuked it, he reproved it. So when he sat down, this Pharisee, he marveled. Jesus wouldn't even do that. He wouldn't obey. Then Jesus gave the lesson. And the Lord said unto him in verse 39, now do you Pharisees make clean the outside of the cup and the platter? Giving them a lesson now on the outside, what the Pharisees did. But your inward part, the inward man, the soul and the spirit. What is the inward part of man? It's the soul and the spirit. Because your outward is the body. But the soul and the spirit is never seen by the eye. The eye can never see the soul. Never has. There's not one of you ever seen a soul with your eye or seen a spirit. You have seen a manifestation of the soul. And you've seen a manifestation of a spirit or the spirit. But not you can't see it. He said, now, you fail, you clean the outside of the vessel, the cup and the platter. But your inward part is full of ravening and wickedness, full of evil. You fools, you foolish men, did not he that made that which is without make that which is within also? So there's two beings that God formed. The Lord God breathed the breath of life into the dust of the earth, and man became a living soul. Now there was the one part, the man, but God created the second part, the soul. He said, the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground. That man was as lying there as still as a statue, and would have continued to lie in that dust where God formed him, Adam, the first man, if God had not breathed into him and gave him the breath of life and made him then a living soul. As soon as the breath of life, someone said, what was the breath of life? The Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost. I've heard men say that was oxygen. God breathed oxygen in his lungs. That was not what made the soul alive. The oxygen in your lungs does not make your soul alive.
No, it did not.
It keeps the body alive, but it doesn't make your soul alive.
No, sir.
In the 20th chapter, someone run reference for me on that. Brother David, if you will and can, back there, someone. In the 20th chapter of John, just before Jesus ascended back to heaven, he gathered his disciples out to the mountain and to Bethany out that way, somewhere in that direction. And he breathed on them. He breathed on them and said, receive you the Holy Ghost.
2022.
What is it? What chapter?
2022, John.
John, 2022. He breathed on them and said, receive you the Holy Ghost. Now, every one of those disciples was in the upper room. And they did receive the Holy Ghost. They didn't receive it there. See, they didn't receive it there just because Jesus said, receive, when he said this, he breathed on them and saith unto them, receive you. In other words, you're going to receive, or I've loosed the Holy Ghost upon you. It will come. And on the day of Pentecost, it did come. They didn't receive it. They received it on the day of Pentecost. But they received the permission of God for the Holy Ghost to come on them through Christ. There, receive you the Holy Ghost. In Luke 11:40, you fools, did not he that made that which is without make that which is all within also? Now, the Spirit of God can only live in the soul and the spirit.
Yes.
The spirit of man can live in the body.
Yes.
And the soul and the spirit. That's why man is carnal without God.
Yes.
Because that nature of the fallen man is in the whole being of man and woman, womankind. The soul, the body, the spirit. But the nature of God cannot dwell in your body. It has nothing to do with your sensual side. The Holy Ghost in you has to come and control the body and make the body a temple and the Holy Ghost dwell in it. The Holy Ghost has to teach your body to dress right, to dress holy, to dress godly. If you're a woman, the Holy Spirit has to teach you to dress where a man will not look at your body while you're trying to do the will of God, while you're trying and you're being used of God and God is witnessing through you. God doesn't want any carnal thing going on with you. He doesn't want any carnal eye lusting after you. So then the woman has to dress holy, godly. What do you mean holy? Clothe her body to where her body is not tempting the flesh of the carnal man. You say, well, a spiritual man wouldn't be tempted.
Right.
No, but all men are only spiritual in the Holy Ghost. They still have the carnal. So you still have the carnal nature when Christ is in the inner nature, in the inner man. Yeah, there's still the carnal nature. That's the outer man. We have scriptures for that here. So then what does the man do? The man has to watch himself and see that he too is not tempting by his actions, by his dress also, by his mannerism, by his flirtation, by his letting himself take the vessel that is watching him, observing him. See, because the inner man is always trying to drive back the outer man.
Yes.
The outer man, the carnal man, is always trying to invade the inner man.
Yes.
That's the warfare. Sure. Invade his language, invade his temper, invade his speech, invade his mind, invaded senses, invaded feelings of sensitivity, seeing, smelling, telling, tasting, hearing, feeling, the five senses. The outer man is always trying to come in to the five spiritual senses and drive them back and supplant them with his carnal nature. That goes on in a child of God. When you receive the Holy Ghost, that nature of the outer man is driven back from the throne of your heart. And Christ occupies the throne of your heart because you become a new creation, new in your spirit, new in your soul. But the outer man is still there, still resisting. And people don't understand this. They fall into temptation. They backslide. They allow themselves to be used of the serpent because they don't understand that how that God, this is a real revealing verse right here, verse 40. You fools, he said, you fools, did not he that made that which is without make that which is within also? See, the cup and the platter, they were always cleansing it with the outward thing. But he said inwardly, you're full of you're ravening and wickedness, Brother Dennis.
I just had a quick question, just so I'm clear on.
Yes.
I'm drawing a blank. I believe I know wisdom, knowledge, faith, the senses of the spiritual man. What are they?
The five senses of the spiritual man are the same as the natural man, only they become a new creation, and the old man remains the old creation.
Okay.
So you have seeing, smelling, tasting, hearing, feeling. That's what you live by. That's what I live by. I see, I hear, I taste, I smell, I feel. All right, I do the same thing in the new man, the inward man. When I'm with Christ, when I'm with his, and I'm with Christ, and I can sense him, feel him, taste him, smell him, hear him. When I'm in worship, I can see, taste, smell, hear, feel. When I'm studying the Word, in those inner senses that are spiritual, the spiritual man. See, you didn't have the spiritual man before you came to Christ. Adam did not have the spiritual man before the Lord God breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. He became. So what was he before he became a living soul? He was a dead soul. He was a form. He was a man. But the Lord God formed man, that which was first, out of the dust of the ground. Then he breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, breathed into him the breath of life, and he became a living soul. When you receive the Holy Spirit in your life, first you repented, you were converted, first you offered your animal on the brazen altar, first you were accepted by the priest, the high priest, and then the old man was burned, the beast was burned, and the blood was shed of the natural person, the natural woman, the natural man. And then you were worthy then for you then to receive Christ as a new creation, and you became a priest of God. The church is likened unto royal nation, holy priesthood, chosen generation. So as a priest then of God, you as a child of God, a priest of God, a chosen generation, you were allowed to go in the holy place. And in the holy place, you found an altar that was golden, the golden altar, Christ, who had good incense, sweet incense. And from the blood of the brazen altar to the golden altar incense, the Holy Ghost, then you were able to look around and see with the inner man by the seven spirits of God, the seven lights of God, the seven lamps of God, because you were in the Holy Ghost. If you could stay in that perfect place that you were when you received Christ, when he came into your life, if I could have stayed there and I would have not gone out, then I would not be dealing with the old man. But we go in and out. The book of Revelation said we will come to the place where we go no more in and out. you know, we won't do that. We'll go in God, in Christ, and no more out. We won't leave the holy place. Okay, any questions, any things on John?
It's a lot of difference between having Christ in you and you being in Christ.
Yes, sir. Well, a total world of difference. Yes. See, I have Christ in me now.
Yes.
I'm striving to be in Christ. See, I have Christ in me. I'm striving to be in, and I have Christ in me. I'm striving to be in Christ. He's in me. In my perfection, I'll be in Christ, and I'll no more go out. I don't go out then. I'm in the temple. I'm in the holy place, and that's what we're striving for. Did you know that knowledge is not taught in churches?
No, it's not.
I don't care. Turn any television program you want. Turn any, read any books written lately.
No.
And the nature of the old man, the outer man, the old man. Why is he the old man? Because he was there before the new man came. That makes him the older. That makes him the old man. He was there before the new man came. So now, he couldn't be the inward man then, because Christ now lives in your soul, your spirit. So he's not the inward man. He isn't the inward Christ. He's the outer man of the flesh, the Adamic nature, the fallen nature of Adam. But you still deal with him, don't you?
Sure you
do. I still deal with him, don't I?
Yes.
Every day. Every day. You do too. Unless you're perfect, and I think that I'm perfect in some things, but not all things. But I'm striving to be completely perfect, even as God, our Father, which is in heaven, is perfect. And that's another thing you won't hear taught in the churches today. Perfection on this earth. You won't hear that taught, because they don't believe you can be. But the Bible teaches you can be. You can be totally mature, totally formed. The old man suppressed, destroyed. Paul shows that in Romans 12, the 12th chapter of Romans. Mm-hmm. Paul said, "Wherefore, brethren, I beseech you, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present. But it's up to you. You have to do it.
Yeah.
You have to work out your salvation
yeah.
with fear and trembling.
Yeah.
You present your body a living sacrifice, holy. That means spirit, soul, and body. There's another scripture to go with that. I'll finish that one. Present your body a living sacrifice, holy, completely, W-H-O-L-L-Y. If you present your body W-H-O-L-L-Y, you'll present it H-O-L-Y, holy, holy. You know, you present your body first completely, then it becomes holy. If you withhold some of it, it won't be H-O-L-Y. You have to make it W-H-O-L-Y to make it complete. And so, completely presented. Present your body a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Be not conformed to this world. To this world. Be not conformed to the world, but be you transformed. That the only way you can be transformed is the Holy Ghost take hold of you, work in you, and you go to war, and me go to war, and don't back off, and don't retreat.
Keep
the three R's in you. I keep three R's in my life. No retreat, no regret, no remorse. Forward in the Lord. No retreat, no regret. No remorse. You know, if you're sorry because you became a Christian, every day you say, "I wish I'd have never found this way. I wish I'd have never got acquainted with Jesus. Had a better time in the world than I have serving the Lord. I would to God I had never come around this place." Brother Marlon, have you ever seen people? Yes, I have. In my years in ministry, my years in the church, I've seen people say, "I wish I had never seen the church. I wish I had never been around this place. Wish I had never." That's dangerous. You're right on the edge of blaspheming the Holy Ghost. And when you get in that kind of condition, see, No, be glad and rejoice that the Lord calls you and presents your body a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, your reasonable service. So the end, and so Jesus said, and I think you get this, I hope you get this 40th verse. Did not he that made that which is without, the natural, make that which is within also, which is the soul and the spirit, that becomes a new creation in receiving Christ in you, the hope of glory. All right, before we go to another scripture, anyone with a comment or a question? Brother Butch, Brother Hagin.
Unless I misunderstood you, did you just not say a few moments ago, you said there are churches that teach that you can't, that you can reach perfection or you cannot reach perfection, and is it not true that, that you preach or you have preached, I think I've heard, that you said that as long as we have this body, this carnal body of man, we'll never reach perfection.
With the mortal being.
Right.
But the exterior is still corruptible. But the perfection is in the soul and spirit, that which is within. But the only way that I'll be completely finished in my perfection, go in and no more out, is when this mortal puts on immortality. Then the work's done completely. The body then is presented completely as a living sacrifice. I'm perfect in my soul and spirit. I'll have to be perfect in my soul and spirit, in the inward man, for me to present my body a living sacrifice. But then Christ only can take me from mortal to immortal. See, Paul, that's plain. And if you have a problem with that way I say that, let me go further. In 1 Corinthians 15, I'm going to quote these verses, and it's on the screen now. For this corruptible, so it's corruptible, isn't it? See, anything corruptible is not perfect, is it? It's corruptible. Must put on incorruption. But when does this body right here, is corruptible? When does it finish the work of perfection? When it puts on incorruption. Now you're incorruptible inside, but your body is still corruptible. It ain't gonna live forever. It's still subject to being taken out. It will be. It's still corruptible. The body is still, this doesn't go to heaven. This doesn't go to heaven. The corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put, so when this is done, we could go on to those other verses. So when this is done, then later on down he says, then we have the victory over death and the sting of death. Old death, where's thy sting? Oh, great, where's thy victory? It doesn't have any, because when that body goes back to the grave, that soul and that spirit is not there. Soul and the spirit's not in that body. So the grave doesn't have any victory over that. That which is corruptible is going into the grave, done away with. But that which is not is then taken into a new house. Got two people here with questions. Let me grab Dennis here and I'll come back to you, Renee.
Okay, I had just a couple quick questions. The one was where I was tracking before. Is it seven gifts of the Spirit? Wisdom, knowledge, discerning of spirits. I'm not thinking, is that what was
I? No, I'm not dealing with the gifts now.
Okay. But that's what those are, the gifts.
But the gifts do work.
Okay.
They do work. Right. Those gifts do work.
And then one other quick question. When we talk about that body, there's a point when Jesus, after the resurrection, and he's returned, and he makes himself visible to the apostles, he has Thomas wants to
handle me and see,
and he's there in the flesh, and then he actually eats with them. Is this, because I've heard a couple different points of view on this, and I don't know that it actually says biblically, but I'd like to hear your thoughts on that. As far as, will we be eating food once we're transformed to?
We really have no biblical evidence of that in the scriptures. That we'll be in heaven eating around big tables, eating food, sumptuously faring with, like it's painted in the paintings in the tradition of the church. I can't see where that would correlate to the scriptures because there's no evidence of it. Jesus himself, we have even in the examples we can use after the resurrection of Jesus in his glorified body, it doesn't clearly say, it said, he said, children come and dine.
Yes.
He fixed a meal for them.
Yes, he did.
It doesn't really clearly say that Jesus himself sat and ate with them. Then on the road to Emmaus, when they invited him into the house, and he took the bread and broke it, but it never shows him eating. And that's the nearest thing we have to an example where Christ would be eating. But finish up the question, Brother Dennis. I don't see in the scriptures where there's any evidence of them eating in the heavenlies, partaking of food, natural food. In fact, I don't see any evidence of anything earthly, including a mortal body, being in heaven. I don't see anything in the scriptures. I think it will be a completely different setting and scene when we were in third heaven.
So Christ in his glorified body was for the purpose of making himself visible and available there
for the proof to the disciples. 40 days and 40 nights he showed himself alive by many infallible proofs. 40 days and 40 nights. Let me get Renee back here.
So once you reach perfection at that point, you are considered dead as far as earth goes, correct? Like your feet will never touch and be perfect, right?
On this earth, you mean? When we are perfect on this earth, we are without sin working in our body. We are dead to sin. We are dead. The only thing left is the mortal body that has to be changed. That's the finishing work that he does before he translates that soul and that spirit in you that is sinless, that is not living in sin, not practicing sin. You're dead to sin. You're a new creation. You're an overcomer. But the only thing God then has to do is get you out of that house. And he does that by death. And death then releases you. And oh, death then, where is thy sting? Oh, grave, where is thy victory? Because your body is still corruptible. It's going to die. But your soul and spirit is perfect before Christ, before him. Because otherwise, you won't move out of the body, a living soul. You won't move out of it. Let me get Brother Lee and I'll come back to you, Brother. All right?
Okay, this is just, I wanted to add this scripture to what you're saying, Hebrews 5 and 14, because I'm back on the senses. You know, the five natural senses,
uh-huh.
Five spiritual senses. Uh-huh. And then this brings...
Now speak up where they can hear you.
This brings a question. Who by reason of use, having their senses exercised to discern both good and evil.
Mm-hmm.
So then my thought is, my natural senses didn't have too much value, but my spiritual senses would.
Yes, Brother Lee.
God, I can see with these right here, but that don't help me with my soul.
No, Brother Wallace was saying, I agree, that my natural senses would never discern good from evil. My natural senses would want to go partake of evil. You know, when I'm seeing, I'm feeling, I'm tasting, I'm hearing, I'm smelling things that are lustful, things that stir me up, things that are carnal, things that stir my natural appetite. I don't discern any evil in that. That's why people do it. That's why people go and just commit evil. That's why a man stays out in the bar until late at night. That's why a man can kill another man without a conscience. That's why I can do anything that's earthly, sensual, because I can't discern good from evil with my natural senses. It's only when the new creation is in me, when God is in me, when Christ is in me, and he lets me taste that evil. It's evil in my sense. I see it, I feel it, I hear it, so I back away from it. I become an overcomer because I have those five senses that are working toward that, the inward man. I have the inward man. The inward man is then discerning, because Christ that made me with just the natural man until he breathed in me the breath of life, the Holy Ghost, then I became a new creation. And now I'm to refrain from that that which I love, I now hate. That which I hated, I now love. You know, I've reversed myself. All right?
Hebrews 5, 12, 13, 14.
Hebrews 5 and 12. 13, all right. Yeah, for when the time you ought to be teachers, you have need that one teach you again, which be the first principles of the oracles of God, and to become such as have need of milk and not of strong meat. For everyone that uses milk is unskillful in the word of righteousness. Doesn't understand it. It's something he doesn't want, I don't understand. For he is a babe, but strong meat. And we've got some strong meat here tonight. We're dealing with strong meat. But strong meat. More than John 3:16. For strong meat belongeth to them that are of full maturity, full age, even those who by reason, they've done something about it. There's a reason they're strong. There's a reason they're not a babe. They don't use milk. It's because they have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. Okay, I've got several hands up. Sister Marla, I'll take yours in, then I'll try to come over. Brother Ernest, you're good.
In response to Brother Dennis' question, many people feel, because in Revelation 19 and 9, it says, blessed are they that are called to the marriage supper of the Lamb. Mm-hmm. But if you read the 17th and 18th verses, it isn't.
Yeah,
it
notice,
isn't a big feast.
Yeah, this may imply that there's a great banquet feast in the natural called, you know, the supper, the marriage supper of the Lamb, when Christ comes, and put your mind on banquet tables and feeding and a host of all that. But if you read that, Revelation 19, is it?
Right.
Yeah. It doesn't say in verse what, Sister Marlo?
Well, it's
blessed are they which are eating.
No, it's 17th verse.
The 17th verse of Revelation 19, but it says, we have it here in verse 17, and I saw an angel standing in the sun, and he cried with a loud voice, saying to all the fowls that fly in the midst of heaven, come and gather yourselves together unto the supper of the great God. Fowls, vultures, carnivorous birds of the air, vultures. That's who's going to eat.
In the 18th verse.
See, they said, come and gather yourselves together, the fowls of the air. And the verse of the 18 shows you why. That you may eat the flesh of kings, and the flesh of captains, and the flesh of mighty men, and the flesh of horses, and of them that sit on them, and the flesh of all men, both free and bond, both small and great. You wouldn't want to eat of that supper.
No.
That's Armageddon.
Sure it is.
That's bloated carcasses of thousands of men and women, horses, animals that are lying rotting in the sun following the destruction of the Battle of Armageddon. Which is the marriage supper of the Lamb.
Yes.
See, the scripture doesn't show that we're called to eat a big banquet table. We're celebrating the coming of Christ.
Right.
He's destroyed people in Armageddon. People have died by the hundreds, the thousands, and the flesh of captains, mighty men, bond men, are rotting in the sun, the carcasses. And the angel says to all the fowls flying they have flesh devouring. Come eat. Come eat. I'm not eating of that supper. And, but I'm, where I want the verse where it says, blessed are they which are called to the marriage supper of the Lamb.
Verse 9.
See, it's wonderful to be called to the marriage supper of the Lamb.
But doesn't the normal church teach that that's a big feast?
Well, yes, most of the churches teach that that is a big feast of food, banqueting. But look, and if you don't see this, it's all right, because I didn't see it the first time I heard it either. But look at the scripture. And he saith unto me, right, blessed are they which are called, not eating, they're called unto the marriage supper of the Lamb. That's Armageddon. That's when Christ comes again with his entourage, with the bride of Christ from heaven. That's his open coming.
Right.
When he comes back to this earth with his open coming, the secret coming is when he comes for the bride.
Yes.
The open coming is when he comes back with the bride, the overcomers. And they're coming back now, and it's Armageddon. Armageddon is taking place. The most horrible battle ever fought on the face of the earth. Seven trumpets of judgment being unleashed on the earth. And it said, blessed are they which are called. Well, sure, if you're called to that marriage supper of the Lamb, that means you're with a bride. You're with the Lamb.
Yeah.
You're part of his bride. Yeah. You're coming back with him. That's a celebration of Christ over the evil of the devil. He's getting ready to shut the devil up in a bottomless pit for 1,000 years. And it's a celebration. So blessed are they which are called, not eating, but called unto that marriage supper of the Lamb. All right? Now, we've got a lot of hands up. Let me catch Brother Ernest down here.
Well, we're in the 24th chapter of Luke.
24th chapter of Luke, now we're in. All right?
In the 41st verse, as after when he appeared to them and said, while they yet believed not for joy and wondered, he said unto them, have ye any meat? And they gave him a piece of broiled fish and a honeycomb, and he took it.
And he ate.
And did eat before them.
Yes, he did. That is clarification on that he did eat. He had the power to eat. He was Christ. He was showing himself alive. He was witnessing. So would he do that again in heaven? Well, first of all, if he's in heaven around the throne of God with the bride of Christ, he would have to find, there would have to be creeks, rivers where the fish were. Somebody would have to catch them.
Yeah.
And they'd have to repeat themselves. Now, is that possible in heaven, third heaven? It's possible, because you and I have never been there, and we don't know. And the mystery is what we don't know. And we know less about heaven than we know about heaven. I would trade all I know about heaven for what I don't know, wouldn't you? And we get the best of the trade. But so is it, when you say, is it possible? It is possible. I can't say that I see in the scriptures the necessity of in heaven, not on the earth, but in the heaven, that we would eat and partake of them, because that was natural food.
Yeah, sure it was. Yeah.
Now, he had the power to do that. He was Christ.
There won't be no natural food.
But in heaven, would there be natural food?
No.
Would there be bass in the stream like there is? Here, someone said, well, God could put them there. He could, but then why would he put natural in the spiritual?
That's it.
You know, why would he do that? Because, you know, he doesn't need the natural there. Here was the natural. He had the natural. He performed his miracles before them in the natural. So I wouldn't be disputing and argumentative about it, because I've never been to heaven. I can't say that I absolutely am right, that there's nothing there. Maybe if God wants to, he could create fish that are not terrestrial fish. They could be celestial fish. After all, he created celestial angels. So if you want to create a celestial fish, I don't know, would it be trout, right? Would it be perch? Would it be?
I don't know, bass.
What would it be? I don't, you know. You know, just have to speculate from that point. You, someone said goldfish.
So I said the lion would lay down with the lamb, is that at the first?
That's on the new earth.
On the new earth.
On the new earth, 65th chapter of Isaiah. The lamb laying down, you know, with a wolf and the lion and a little child leading them. 65th chapter of Isaiah, that's the new earth. That's earth. Those animals are here, and but the nature's taken out of the lion and so on. Now, let me see, let me get hands. All of you that had your hands up a moment, you raise your hand. All right, I'm going to take the one that hasn't asked a question yet, and I'll come back to you that have. Brother Darrell.
You know, the Bible speaks of the celestial treasure that you spoke of there. There are two different bodies. One has one glory and one has another. Where we see the problem, or where I see the problem in many of the churches today, they don't know how to separate those bodies.
That's what we're talking about. That's the subject tonight. See, they don't know how to separate the inward man from the outward man, because your inward man is a body. It is a body. It's Christ in you. It's not mist. It's not air. It's the very nature, the essential nature of Jesus Christ embodies himself in the Holy Spirit. So it is a body of Christ in you, and you become the body of Christ. I wanted to get 1 Corinthians 15, and I know there are many questions, so I'll comment brief, but because this subject, we've still got some juice in this subject. We haven't ground it all out yet. I see that there's still some cane juice, heavenly juice in this. 1 Corinthians 15, in the verse I want here, 1 Corinthians 15, get down to the verse I want. 39. Okay. Yeah, well, let me take 37. And that which thou sowest, no, verse 36. Verse 35. But some man will say, how are the dead raised up? And with what body do they come? Okay.
Yeah.
Let's hear Brother Paul on this.
Come on.
Thou fool, that which thou sowest is not quickened, except it die. In other words, what was Paul saying? Don't be foolish. That natural body has to die. If you sow it, it has to die before it's quickened. So it can't come forth as that body, can it? If it dies. If it dies, it can't come forth as the same body. Well, right now, he said in verse 37, and that which thou sowest, sowest where? Sow in death. What? Thou sowest not that body that shall be. Remember, he's talking about the resurrection here. But bare grain. It may chance of wheat or some other grain. See, wheat is good grain. It could be good grain you sow. When you sow your body in death, whatever day that is, for me or for you, when it's sowed in death, what body will it come forth with? Paul was saying. Well, look, don't be foolish. It can't come forth unless it dies, because you sow it. It has to be quickened. So when it comes forth, it may by chance be wheat. An overcomer's body.
Yeah.
Or it could be some other grain. It may be barley.
Yeah.
Maybe it's the 60-fold. Maybe it's the 30-fold. Maybe it's the resurrection of the just. Maybe it's the resurrection of the unjust. See, what body does it come forth with? By chance. By grace. By grace. It can be an overcomer's body. It can be a new house. If it is, Paul tells us, but God giveth it a body as it has pleased him. Is God going to give you the body of those written in the Lamb's Book of Life? That will be a celestial body. That's an overcomer's body. That's a new house, not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. See? But God giveth it a body. That's up to God. He's the judge. See? As it pleased him. And to every soul, every seed, his own body. What seed do I fall into the ground when my body is sowed in death? Is it the seed of righteousness? Is it the seed of holiness? Is it the seed of faith?
Come on.
The seed of justification of God? What seed is it? See, remember the seed that fell on the ground in the parable? Some fell on stony ground.
Yeah.
Some fell among thorns. Some fell in good ground. What seed is it? Because the grave is not going to change you. What I fall into, what I'm sowed in, that I will be.
Yeah.
You know. And God then gives it a body. It has pleased him. See, I don't believe in the gospel of second chance.
No, sir.
I believe this is my chance.
Right now.
This is my time.
Right.
I'm hearing the word of God. I've been touched by the Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
I've been given revelation. This is my day. Yep. I'm living now.
Yeah.
The dead praise not the Lord.
That's
neither
it.
Any that go down into silence.
Right.
Death cannot praise thee. The dead cannot celebrate. You know. So he said, now go a little further. All flesh is not the same flesh. I see. But there's one kind of flesh of men, another flesh of beasts, another of fishes, another of birds. They're also celestial bodies, heavenly, and bodies terrestrial, earthly. But the glory of the celestial is one, and the glory of the terrestrial is of another. My celestial body, if I receive that as my reward in death, sowing of death, it won't be the same as the body of Jesus was celestial. It was not the same as the disciples, which were terrestrial. There's a difference in that flesh. Now, he was flesh. See, he was flesh.
Flesh and bone.
Are angels flesh as far as substance? Angels are spirit. There's never any scripture that tells us that angels have fleshly bodies, as Jesus had. Jesus is the only one that has the particular glorified body he has. The only one. Because it was God's glory to give that to him so he would bear the image of the cross even till his return back to this earth.
Yes.
He's the only one. There's not another created angel that has the side where the spear was.
Come on.
See, there's not one. He has. He had the ability to eat that fishes there and to demonstrate his being among them. They did because they were terrestrial. He did because he was Jesus and he had a glorified body. So they can do that. It's possible. So anyway, I don't want to be too lengthy on that. But the glory of the celestial is one, and the glory of the terrestrial is another. Now I'll go back and let any questions, hands that were up, Brother Darrell had it. Now someone has a question. Someone else has a question. Okay, go ahead, Brother Lee. You had a question.
Well, maybe it isn't a question. It's just going back to the fowl. You speaking of those fowls
of the air,
the kingdoms, and the supper of the Lamb. How those fowls? That isn't a good thing. To really want to be in if it's got a foul spirit. And it's what I was picking up from that part. You were talking about that a little bit ago, and then I thought of Job. As well, and that's where you're at now. Job 28 and 7. There is a path which no fowl knoweth, in which the vulture's eye has not seen. So that would be related, same, and if I end up in something I think's real great, but isn't, you know, saying eating the flesh of the kings of the earth and all that, because you kept using that word foul.
Yes, you're interrelating F-O-W-L, the bird, the Canavius bird. You're interrelating that, but that's good. The picture of the F-O-U-L, foul, which means rancid, stinking, bad odor, bad spirit. You're saying that bad spirits can feed on the flesh of men also, right? Foul spirits, as well as the F-O-W-L here in Revelation. Both feed on the flesh. A foul spirit and feeds on the flesh of another being, another person, and can devour. A foul, F-O-W-L, a vulture, in the natural, feeds on the natural flesh and devours. So I see that, yes. Yeah. Somebody said a foul spirit, F-O-U-L, is like a foul ball. You can't run home on it. I'll say that again so you'll be sure to get that. A foul spirit, F-O-U-L, is like a foul ball. You can't run home. So avoid it. It's just a little humorous thing. Okay, the inward man, Luke, there, let's read another scripture, Romans 7:22. Let's take several scriptures here. Romans 7:22, and look at the scriptures, and we're going to read these scriptures. 7:22 deals with the inward man. And the 7th chapter of Romans, I love the 7th chapter of Romans. Verse 22, for I delight in the law of God after the inward man. See, the inward man relates to the law of God. Your delight in the law of God is only in the inward man. There's nothing in your natural man that enjoys this Bible study. Nothing. There's nothing in your inward, your flesh, that is the outward man, not the inward man, the outward man, your flesh, that hungers to be in another study of the Word of God, to pick up your Bible and read it and understand it. That's because that the flesh lusteth after the things of the flesh. The spirit goeth after the things of the spirit. They're contrary one to the other. Paul said they were. They're not together. I'm trying to get that scripture in Galatians where Paul said the flesh lusteth against the spirit, and the spirit warreth against the flesh, and these two are contrary one to the other. Galatians 6, is it? Or 5? Galatians 5.
5:17.
For the flesh, verse 17, for the flesh lusteth, in other words, it's strong against the spirit. That's the outward man, the flesh. That's not, by the way, that's not the skin. The skin here doesn't at all war against God. It's what's in the skin, what flows through the nerve structure, transmits from the mind, that wars against God.
Carnal man, right?
The carnal man. For the flesh lusteth against the spirit, and the spirit against the flesh, and these are contrary, they're different, they're opposite, the one to the other, so that you cannot do the things that you would in your flesh. But if you be led of the Spirit, you're not under the law. Goes on. Now, go back to Romans 7:22. I want to get that because these scriptures are so powerful. and good, in 7:22, for I delight in the law of God after the inward man, after the inward man. Then go to 2 Corinthians 4:16. 2 Corinthians 4:16. Okay. Only time I don't like my Bible is these thin pages. Okay. For which cause, 2 Corinthians 4:16, for which cause we faint not. But though our outward man perish, ceases to exist, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. So one's going to perish, the other one can be renewed day by day. The outward man, and do we really understand those terms? Outward man. You mean, Brother Marlowe, I've got somebody out of me here, over here, that's out? No, he's out of where Christ lives. He and Christ don't occupy the same throne. Your heart can't have two masters. You can't serve two. I can't serve two. One of them is either the outward man or he's the inward man. Christ is the inward man, the Adamic, fallen, sensual, inherited nature of the genes in you, of your progenitors, going back to Adam the father in the garden. That is the outward man. He's not a separate being over here, yet he is a separate being because he no longer occupies the throne of your heart and your mind, and the heart is in the mind, and the soul is in the mind. He no longer occupies that because the inward man occupies it.
Yeah.
And the inward man says, get out.
Get out. Strong man's out.
Now the outward man, your sensual nature, the fallen nature, the old man, will come right back.
Yeah.
And say, I'm not going. You have to throw me out. I'm not going. You want a raw dog fight on your hands, Holy Spirit, Holy Ghost? Come on, I'm going to take you on.
Yes,
and you'd better have the stronger inward man than the outer man. And the only way the inner man can be stronger is by eating Christ, feeling the Holy Spirit, living in Christ, living in the Spirit. Because otherwise, you'll have some of God, but not enough to come against the outer man. There are people who have God in them, but he's not strong because he's not been nourished and fed. You haven't nourished Christ in you, so he's the weaker. But you fed the outer man, he's the stronger. And brother, you can't do it. I can't do it. Because it's Christ in me. That's the hope of glory. So I love Romans 7:22. I love 2 Corinthians 4:16. For which cause we faint not, though our outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. One other verse of scripture, the choir's coming in, and it's time to relinquish time to them. Psalms 51:10. This is a very good verse to deal with. Psalms 51:10. Psalms 51:10. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit. Where? Within me. Within me. Create in me a clean heart. Why? Because the old heart was not clean. From the time I became a young man and got to know good and evil, and I could partake of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, When I no longer was an innocent child, I could partake of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And that wasn't too late in life. I learned the tree of the knowledge of good and evil very early. And I learned to eat of that tree. And it led me astray.
Yeah.
As it did them in the garden.
Yes.
the tree of the knowledge of good and evil is the part of your nature that is called Adam, the old man, the old, someone said, but I'm a woman. You're still an old man, there's still an old man in there. Though you're a woman, there's an old man in there. And that old man is Adam, the first man. And so you have to deal with that because you don't have a clean heart. David found out the old man ruled him the day he went to the rooftop and looked upon Bathsheba.
Yes,
and his troubles began in a multitude. He found the old man in him
stronger.
With the old heart overcome the shepherd boy. David, the shepherd boy.
Yes,
and he found that he had problems because he partook of the tree of the knowledge of good and of evil.
He didn't deserve it.
Someone said, Brother Marlowe, you don't really believe that there was not, that wasn't a natural tree growing in the garden. Well, let me give you a thought. Then there would be groves of trees today, as wicked as the world is, and as evil as man is, there would be groves of trees growing where people were going out. I think I'll have me a fruit of adultery today. I think I'll have me a fruit of this corruption or that corruption. It'd be, if it were natural. If that was natural, then that was natural then, it would be natural outside the garden.
Yeah.
Because God cursed the earth, and the curse would have gone out of the garden, into the earth. No, it wasn't. Adam was a tree. The Bible pictures us as trees.
Yes.
The Bible calls us trees, trees of righteousness, also trees of good and evil. There's good in you, but there was evil there also. That's why Christ has to come in and take the evil, bind it, and cast it away from you, and you overcome. You become an overcomer, because the outward man then will, that reaches out, he puts him out. Christ puts the flesh out of the house, he rules. And the outward man perishes, and the inward man is renewed day by day. Create within me a clean heart. David knew God had to do that. Oh God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of my salvation, and uphold me with a free spirit.
He said,
renew. Because David had lost that spirit of grace. He had to have it renewed. Okay, let's see. I've got two verses of scriptures, and we're done. On the inward man. We never did get the scriptures on the old man. But we've got them, and we'll get them. And then following that are scriptures on the new man. The new man, though, we have some of that in the scriptures on the inward man. Now let me run quickly. 2 Corinthians 12, 2 and 3, and we'll wrap it up here. 2 Corinthians 12, 2 and 3. Come here, come here. Second Corinthians 12, 2 and 3. In 2, he said, I knew a man in Christ above 14 years ago. That's when he was in the Arabian desert, speaking of himself. Whether in the body, I cannot tell. Or whether out of the body, I cannot tell. God knoweth. Such a one caught up to the third heaven. And I knew such a man. Whether in the body or out of the body, I cannot tell God. I want to give you a little thought. Why did Paul, I've never said this before. I don't think I've ever taught a class. Why did Paul keep saying twice, whether in the body or out of the body, I cannot tell. He meant he couldn't tell. Say it twice, two witnesses. Because when Paul was caught up in the Spirit, and caught up to the level of paradise, heaven. He was in his body, but he was in the spirit.
Yeah.
It was impossible for Paul to separate the body and the spirit and to know whether or not he had been translated out, or whether translation of the spirit was taking place in the body. Now, I want to go beyond Paul, because I believe that God has revealed knowledge from Paul's experience in this day to a teaching ministry. And I believe that I see what Paul may not have understood. I'm saying that Paul was less than I am. I just believe revelation precedes revelation, and revelation follows revelation. And I believe today there's greater knowledge of some things those apostles said that they didn't understand fully, but it was written for our benefit.
Yes.
And for us getting closer to God. I believe that you, Paul, was an overcomer. I believe he said, whether in the body or out of the body, I cannot tell. He was in his body. But when you are an overcomer and you're separated from your sensual self in an experience with God, and I've had those experiences, and now I understand, you don't leave your body. You just become unaware of your body. To where the experience you're having, you can't tell whether you're in the, you couldn't define that. You can't prove, well, I was caught out of the body, because you're out of the body, and you're not in contact with the Adamic spirit, the flesh.
Yes.
You're separated, but yet you're still on the earth, you're still in your body, but you have an experience with God that lifts you away from your body.
Yes.
And that's the glory of it.
Yes.
That's the glory of it. You're caught up to the third heaven.
Yes.
You're caught up into paradise. It's paradiso. It's a beautiful place when you're lost in the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
When you're lost in the Holy Ghost. If you ever had that experience, you'll want to go back and have it again.
Amen.
You'll want to go back and have it again.
Yeah.
And again. Praise God.
Thank you.
Little thought. All right, we got to close it, but I won't leave somebody that just had a vital thought. All right. Have you enjoyed the Bible study?
Yes.
Yes, yes, yes.
We just got into a few scriptures. The inward man, the old man, the new man. Praise God. Anybody got one word? Brother Doug, you seem to have a word.
I just want to know. Wouldn't this all kind of lead back into Corinthians 15, 1 Corinthians 15, verses 42, 43, and 44, where it says, so also is the resurrection of the dead. It is sown in corruption, and it is raised in incorruption.
Yes.
It is sown in dishonor, and it is sown raised in glory. It is sown in weakness, and it is raised in power. As is sown the natural body, is raised the spiritual body.
Goes right back to that. That sowing is in death. See, first the death of the flesh while you're living. Then the sowing of the body to the grave. It's sown a natural body, it's raised a spiritual body. Sown in corruption, raised in incorruption. That's good. There is a natural body and there is a spiritual body. Well, let's keep learning. Let's keep growing. Let's keep seeing what God will do for the assembly here. You all keep praying. Keep drawing closer to God. The core of the church. I have you here on Monday nights. Keep letting the man, outward man, become completely subject to the inward man. And that means just discern in the spirit. Even what you say in words, what you look like on the outside. Somebody said, God doesn't look on the outside He looks on the inside, but man looks on the outside.
Absolutely.
God does see the inside.
Yeah.
I want people to see Christ outwardly. I want to see people to see Christ inwardly.
Yes.
It's true. God seeth not as man seeth. Man looketh on the outward appearance. But I want them to see, since man can't look on the inward, I want him to see Christ on the outward.
Yes,
as well as on the inward.
Yeah.
So let me pray. Let me be led of God. Let me ask God to lead and guide the core of the church. Raise itself up. Get ready. The church is changing.
Yes.
The church is going toward a greater level.
Yes.
This church is going to a higher place.
Never been.
This church is not going into separation and division and iniquity and corruption. It's going toward holiness,
yes,
and righteousness,
yes,
and unity and not division. It's going toward love. Toward the people of God. Oh, I can feel it. Praise God.
Yes, yes, yes.
Can you feel it? My God.
Yes.
Do you actually feel God? Do you feel?
Yes.
Do you actually feel God?
Yes.
Through the Holy Ghost. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. Well, let's do a little feeling of God right now. Let's lift our hands and give God a praise and a shout. Hallelujah, Lord. I love you tonight. I praise your name. I walk, Lord, with you in the Spirit. Glory to God. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the power of God, the power of the Spirit. I believe, Lord, in the holiness of your name, in the glory of your name. My God, I believe in the healing of your name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Let's pray for the people of God of the church. Pray for them. Amen. Mix and mingle right now. And the Lord bless you good. Don't anybody leave without saying something to a neighbor around you. Amen.